Yeah, thank you, Nigel. So this may seem like deja vu. And first, I'd like to say thank you very much for letting us come here and have the opportunity to present our work. And the chemical reaction that we're interested in is the transfer of a hydrogen atom from initially from some molecule A to another molecule B. And in the following, we're just going to ignore the electron and just consider it as a proton transfer reaction. So in the processes that we're interested in, they're catalyzed by an enzyme. And these chemical reactions are done in solution at room temperature. And recently, there's been some evidence to suggest that quantum effects might play a part in this process. So the proton can tunnel from A to B. And the evidence for this is in Judith's paper, Judith Cleland's paper, and in various other sources. So how does one usually go about modeling this type of process? Well, we imagine that the proton sees some one-dimensional potential energy landscape, and the proton is the red blob there. And initially, it's sitting in some potential well attached to molecule A. And if the proton has enough energy to overcome this energetic barrier, and the energy it needs to do that is called the activation energy, then it can proceed into this more energetically favorable region at B. Now, usually one uses transition state theory to calculate rates for such a process. And one of the simplest ways to do this is the following. We imagine that the proton is thermalized in a harmonic oscillator at the bottom of this potential well, and thermalized at some temperature T, oscillating with frequency omega. Then it's suddenly exposed to this potential due to the presence of B. So it creates a non-equilibrium situation for the proton, and if the proton has enough energy, it will hop over, the barrier to the more energetically favorable region. And the probability for it to do so depends on its initial Boltzmann distribution, and the calculated rate for this is given as KTST, the TST transfer stands for transition state theory. So in here we see the initial frequency that it was oscillating with, omega appearing in the prefactor, and in the exponent we have the activation energy. So as the energy increases, the rate is exponentially suppressed, and beta, which is 1 over the Boltzmann constant times the temperature. So as temperature increases, the rate increases. Now this TST rate is an overestimate to the true rate because it doesn't take environmental effects into account, namely damping. So Kramer set about resolving this in his celebrated paper and showed that this rate could be lowered or improved by including a factor that accounts for this environmental damping. Okay, so how are we going to approach this problem? We're going to approach this from a completely quantum perspective. So we're going to take the proton to be fully quantized in this left-hand well, and it's going to evolve with a Schrodinger equation. And so our goal at the end is going to be, just for now, to compare the transition state theory rate with our quantum rate. And this might seem a bit strange because they apply in very different regimes, but we think that we can still make some useful comparisons. Well, they both have a similarity in that they model non-dissipative systems. And we can say things like, because our rate will include both tunneling and hopping components, we expect it to intuitively be higher than the transition state theory rate, which only includes barrier hopping. Okay, so if from the outset we know that our model is not really modeling the true dissipative process, then why are we bothering with it at all? Well, we hope that it will give some good qualitative character to the situation we're describing. So it's going to capture the tunneling properties of a particle moving between two uneven wells with a barrier in between, the exact shape which we don't know, and of course the rate will be sensitive to this, but we hope to see that it has the right characteristics. And our model's flexible, we can change the shape of the barrier, and we can also change the number of energy levels that are tunneling versus those that are hopping. The potentials that we use also have analytically solved Schrodinger equations, so we know their exact eigenstates and eigenvalues, so we don't have to rely on too many numerical calculations. So what potentials are we using? We are going to take the proton to be initially thermalized in the left well in a Morse potential at temperature T. And we're using the Morse because it's a very good approximation to the real energy landscape between two bonded particles. And then the proton will be suddenly exposed to this new potential G to B. So now the question is, what should this new potential look like? Well, as Jim pointed out, it should really be something like a double well, because when the proton moves from this minimum to here, it's not just going to go off to infinity. It's going to stop at some equilibrium position. So we imagine that we fix the position of B, then the proton will go from one equilibrium to another, and this being energetically favorable, it lies at a lower energy. So our potential should assume the shape of an asymmetric double well. Now this is usually where alarm bells start ringing, because one often has to turn to numerical calculations to calculate the eigenvalues and eigenstates of this type of potential. But we didn't want to do this. We wanted to keep our calculations analytical. So the question is now, are there any solved asymmetric double wells? Well, interestingly, supersymmetry holds the answer to this. So there's a whole host of solved potential wells, because they're supersymmetric partners of potentials which already have solved equations. So it's a bit confusing, but essentially, the supersymmetric partner of the harmonic oscillator includes a whole family of wells, and one of those families is a set of asymmetric double wells. So these are some of the supersymmetric partners of the harmonic oscillator, and they have known eigenvalues and eigenfunctions. So picking one of these are the eigenstates of this particular well, and the energy spectrum here. All the energies are the same as the harmonic oscillator, that's the symmetry part of the supersymmetry, except for the ground level, which is shifted. So now if we evolve our proton with this double well, then, so in our simulation, we're also going to input some what we thought were reasonable parameters. So we took the activation energy to be from the ground state energy in the Morse the top of the barrier, to be about 6 kilocalories per mole, which is about 4 × 10⁻²⁰ joules. And we took the transfer distance to be about 0.5 angstrom. Then we also are going to consider this kinetic isotope effect. So we're also going to look at the tunneling rates for a particle of twice the mass, deuterium. And because it has a higher mass, it will have a lower zero-point energy, so it's going to increase the activation energy and therefore suppress the rate. Okay, so doing all this, we obtain the following results. So first, I need to explain how we calculated our quantum rate. So we took our quantum rate as being this function P dot B. So PB is the probability of being at molecule B. And we took this to be the integral of the probability of B we took as being everything to the right-hand side of this maximum. And then we differentiated it with respect to time to get our rate. And from this, we get a time-dependent function. So we have to do some averaging over time. And so after our averaging, we have a quantum rate, which we call KQ, for both hydrogen and deuterium. And here we have almost Arrhenius plots. We took the we expanded this function linearly about the about room temperature, and this is what we get as the rate. So we get the hydrogen rate being here and the deuterium rate being there. So this is a function of beta, the one over temperature, and so it's good. The hydrogen rate is higher than deuterium and it has a very low temperature dependence, which is what we expect from tunneling. And here I've also added. We're able to calculate exactly how much tunneling contributes to this rate versus how much of the proton can hop over. And the KIE that we get, which is basically the quantum rate at room temperature divided by the hydrogen rate divided by the deuterium rate, is 4.5. Usually you see values higher than this, so maybe this isn't quite as high as we want it to be. So this is something for us to investigate further. Now we compare this to this transition state theory rate. So we take omega to be the approximation, harmonic approximation at the bottom of this well. And the activation energy here is the classical activation energy, so taken from the very bottom of the well to the top. So for hydrogen deuterium again, this is the Arrhenius plot that we get. And then we also look at this semi-classical transition state theory, where now the activation energy depends on the zero-point energies of hydrogen and deuterium. And again, we get this sort of graph. So the key thing to take is that, looking at the numbers, that the quantum rate is indeed larger than the transition state theory rate, which is what we expected. Okay, so like I said, we know that our model isn't really capturing the full dynamics of this this chemical process, but we think it has the right qualitative character. In future, we hope to also include dissipation in our model because this is very important, it affects with the environment. We also haven't yet considered what the enzyme action is in all of this. So we'd like to include this as an effective property of the barrier. So the enzyme usually is considered to lower the barrier. So it's catalyzing the reaction. It makes it go faster. So lowering the barrier lower the activation energy and increase the rate. Another way it could change the barrier is by shaking it in a phenomenon known as gating. And this then could provide energy for the proton to hop over the barrier. It could also change the barrier width. And since quantum tunneling is dependent on barrier width, then we'd really expect this last property to heavily affect the rate if the rate depends on quantum tunneling. Compare it to, say, transition state theory, which has no dependence on the barrier width. And something that we've also not included is the roles of these molecules A and B. Do they move around? Is their shape and structure going to have an effect on the transition rate? So yeah, there's lots for us still to do. So thanks for listening.